Welcome, everyone. Thanks for coming out this evening for our conversation about New River Alcera. My name is Mark Gardner, I serve as provost here at Westmont. I want to welcome you to this conversation. We have a very fine group of scholars who have joined us for this talk this evening, and I'm pleased to welcome you. I want to thank also the USC Huntington Institute for the study of the West for helping provide some support for this event. So we're grateful for USC and their role. Our format will be very simple. In just a minute, Greg Orfila will come and frame our conversation. And then after that, we will hear from each of our panelists for about 10 minutes each. Then we're going to give them a little chance to respond to each other, make some comments, and then open it up for questions from all of you. So we're grateful that you're here. Let me just briefly introduce Greg to you. Greg has been teaching in various courses at Westmont from time to time. He's taught English courses. He's taught first-year seminar. He's taught some creative writing courses. He's the author of 8 books, the most recent of which is Journey to the Sun, Junipero Serra's Dream and the Founding of California. But he's also written several other books, quite notably Angelino Days, and has been a nominee for a number of nonfiction literary awards. And so we're grateful to have Greg, who has been really the one that's envisioned this conversation and the one whose scholarly contacts have made it possible. Greg, come and frame it for us. So Greg, welcome.
Welcome. Thank you for coming. Well, believe it or not, this is 2 years in the making. So we're grateful for our guests. We're grateful for our audience to bring about sort of a beginning of something that Mark actually came up with 2 years ago, the Creators of California, as a sort of rubric or notion of a series of panels that we were going to put together over a course of time, and this is number one. And what better way to start than with California's most controversial and celebrated father, Fray Miquel Junipero Serra. I want to thank Mark for his leadership and support of this project from the beginning, and also William Deverell, who's our counterpart at the University of Southern California and chair of the History Department. I also want to mention that of our 4 authors, several of them have books that you can get after the meeting, and I'm sure they'd be happy to damage it for you. We're graced today with 4 distinguished scholars from major California institutions to discuss this wonderfully complicated man from the vantage of 4 disciplines: history, anthropology, archaeology, and sociology, adding my own literature, that makes a 5th, and overarching everything is, of course, theology, or Serra's spiritual legacy. As for relevance, only 2 months ago, President Beebe and I were deeply moved to be present at the canonization as a saint by Pope Francis in Washington, D.C., along with 30,000 other people of course, Serra. Serra is now the first Hispanic saint of the United States and the first of any sort from the American West. Whether you revile him or revere him, here is a man from the 18th century we will and should continue to encounter. Crossing the ocean from Spain to the New World in 1749, running low on water, Serra told his fellow padres, "Talk less, save saliva." I'll try and save some saliva in this brief introduction to the subject and to our guests. The daunting thing about studying Serra's life is just when you think everything about it has been parsed, something new surfaces, if not a whole new way of parsing. I suspect this is true about the most important figures in our history, such as Lincoln, Thomas Jefferson, Martin Luther King, 3 other famously flawed, inspiring individuals. Let's not forget Jefferson's own Declaration of Independence. That pantheon to the Enlightenment contains an indictment of those who, and I'm quoting from the Declaration, endeavored to bring on the inhabitants of our frontiers, the merciless Indian savages, whose known rule of warfare is an undistinguished destruction of all ages, sexes, and conditions. Makes you wonder about Jefferson and the pursuit of happiness. Perhaps one man's enlightenment is another man's anathema. The rudiments of Sarah's life are simple and compelling. He was born in 1713 on the island of Majorca, far from the center of Castilian Spain. He spoke Mallorquin with its dash of French. He said bon dia, not buenos dias. So Sarah was an outsider from the start. He may also have had Jewish and or Arab blood, as do 20% of Spaniards. More outsider, wanting a new world. He became a priest after a lot of inspecting about this outsider blood in his mid-20s and took the name of St. Francis' carefree sidekick, Brother Juniper. For such a serious person as Sarah, it was an intriguing choice. Clearly, he wanted to be lighter. St. Francis' brother Juniper, was famous for all kinds of things, like cooking a stew of live chickens without plucking them. Tossing in, this is into the stew, a few eggs without shelling them. And then after that was all done, riding a seesaw solo for several hours. When I said in my book that Brother Juniper was, in the best sense of the word, crazy, the San Francisco Chronicle thought I was speaking about Sarah. Alas, some reviewers took the Chronicle at face value rather than Journey to the Sun. So, as our third son Luke says, ah well. To finish this off, throwing away a chair in theology at the island's university, Junipero left Mallorca for Mexico in 1749 with more than half his life done. He was 36, hungry to be a missionary. He spent 18 years in Mexico. Then Sarah was sent to California, where 225,000 indigenous people lived. He established 9 of 12 California missions, baptized or confirmed 5,000 Indians, built the first California aqueducts of water, sowed its first fields of grain, planted the first California vineyards, drank their first wine, stretched the El Camino Real to its northernmost point, wrote the 32-point Representación, which some have called the first legal system in California, if not Human Rights Declaration, had 5 near-death experiences, and if that wasn't all enough, he got addicted to snuff. Sarah was, after all, human. On the last night of his life, he said, "I've come under the shadow of fear." I've speculated on what might have caused such a fearless man to be afraid. Could it have been last-minute regret that the floggings in the mission, in the missions for penance and discipline should never have been used? Shortly after Sarah's death at 71 in Carmel, Palo, that's his first biographer and friend, tells us 600 Indians attended his funeral, crying out, heaping his casket with wildflowers. I doubt contemporary protesters know this, and if they do, it may not matter to them. Colonialism is certainly a necessary target, but Sarah is too facile a straw man for it. Otherwise, we forget his radical mercy in San Diego in 1775, when he appealed to the viceroy himself that all rebel Kumeyaay on death row be released. They were. And, as if taking his cue from Junipero, Pope Francis named 2016 the Year of Mercy. It's Sarah who called the Indians gente de razón, people of reason, not the so-called enlightened Governor Neve. Here's my favorite Sarah story in a nutshell. When the first California expedition came upon good, sweet water, that's his phrase, And Portola wanted the water for the horses and the mules and to bathe in. Sarah said, no, quote, we must not spoil the watering place for the Gentiles. Is this the attitude of someone guilty of genocide? Is there any doubt viewing the mile-long stretch of the homeless on Fifth Street in Los Angeles, our prisons bursting, people dying on the border, while politicians talk about building walls, not to mention the death obsession of ISIS, that our world is in desperate need of such compassion and a vision of human dignity? People come to the United States to begin anew. And when they find that it isn't as new as it should be, they come to California. But as Joan Didion has said, the Pacific Edge is where things better work out. Because this is where, Didion says, we run out of continent. And the newness and workings of that irascible outsider, Sarah, despite his failings and blind spots, were large enough for the most inspiring pope since Gregory the Great to lift him out of the 18th century as a saint for us today. Why? Let me quote Pope Francis himself from that amazing day in September in Washington, D.C. He began his homily with a quote from St. Paul, rejoice, first word. Then Pope Francis said, so much stands in the way of this invitation to rejoice. Our daily routine can often lead us to a kind of glum apathy, which gradually becomes a habit. With a fatal consequence, our hearts grow numb. So we ought to ask ourselves, what can we do to keep our heart from growing numb, becoming anesthetized? How do we make the joy of the gospel increase and take root in our lives? In this regard, that's an end quote. In this regard, we might truly ask about Sarah and the Indians, who saved whom? And so Pope Francis told us to adopt Sarah's challenge, to let go the dull and numb heart, to let go despair, and implicitly, the rusted practices of the past in the church, which are not working, by heeding Sarah's own rule of thumb, forward, let's move forward. That was the last sentence of his homily on the canonization. That leads me forward to our panelists. First, it's my pleasure to welcome to Westmont Dr. James Sandoz. Jim Sandoz earned his doctorate at the University of California, Berkeley, and today is Farquhar Professor of the American Southwest at the University of Redlands. Dr. Sandoz has published 4 books, including the seminal work Converting California, Indians and Franciscans in the Missions, published in 2004 on Yale University Press. I believe it's outside too with Les Smith. In it, he says, and I'm quoting from Jim, Franciscan partial success in the missions looks much different when compared to the fate of non-missionized Indians. When I first met Jim several years ago on the verge of diving into Sarah myself, I told him that after converting California, there really wasn't much else to say. It was that good. In his typically generous way, he said, oh no, Greg, there's much more to say about Sarah. I've probably said too much, but Jim.
It's important that I pay some attention to my script. Otherwise, we tend to gas and wheeze, and it plays havoc with the time. But I'd first of all like to thank Greg and Mark for coming together to create this event. I think it's extremely important. I think it's very important to be able to talk about some of these really critical issues. Since January, for 9 months, I have given more interviews, appeared at more things, given more conversations than I care to think about. And I thought at the end of September I was over and done with it, but no. Here I am, and I'm glad to be here, and I appreciate you all coming tonight. The topic of my remarks is Sarah in historical context, colonialism, and allegations of Indian slavery and genocide against the Indians. Those two themes, slavery and genocide against the Indians, I have heard time and time again in the course of this past year. Yeah. They began a long time ago, which we'll touch on later, but 30 years ago, they were just beginning to surface again. But now, in some circles, they are de rigueur. You either agree with it or you are somehow out. As an historian, the historical context of an event is crucial in understanding its meaning or meanings. Context. Canonization is a process that focuses on an individual candidate's life in relationship to that person's spiritual life. Initiating the formal canonization process means that the church has deemed that the candidate, he or she, has lived a life of heroic virtue by the standards of the church. Such deep concentration on the person can, as it has with Sarah, obscure the context. Yes, he was a Franciscan committed to spreading the word of Christianity, the good news or happy news, as it is frequently called. But Sarah was also an agent and abettor of Spanish imperial colonialism. In the Spanish New World, the conquest consisted of two parts. The military suppression of Indian resistance was called the conquista actual, the actual conquest. And the incorporation of Indians into a new mode of life designed to transform them into Spanish-speaking Catholic citizens and laborers. This process was called the conquista espiritual, the spiritual conquest. And in that endeavor, the spiritual conquest of California, Sarah excelled. The spiritual conquest involved erected social change to transform Indians, mainly hunters and gatherers, into the peasant farming population that the new Spanish order demanded. Part of the spiritual conquest required Indians to convert to Catholicism, meaning abandoning their Indian languages and cultures. When baptized, Indians, called neophytes, fled the missions and returned to their homelands. They were pursued and returned by an armed group led by a soldier and aided by armed Indian neophytes. Punishment for running away, as with other crimes and misdemeanors, involved flogging with a whip, being placed in stocks or shackles. This directed social change, I think, is at the heart of the issue we want to interrogate and need to focus on. But first, we must look at these other issues that have come up that I regard as extraneous, but I think we need to face them squarely. Were Indians slaves of the missions? Okay. This is an old charge, first made by the first French visitor to California, La Perouse, who arrived 2 years after Sarah's death. It was La Perouse who compared the missions to Caribbean plantations, which he had recently visited. It was and remains a grossly unfair comparison that is also false. Slaves in the Caribbean, as in the United States, were bought and sold. American slaves reproduced, a very unusual condition throughout the history of slavery in the hemisphere, north and south. American slaves reproduced, and they and their children could be separated and sold individually. When agricultural conditions changed in America, an internal slave trade sent an estimated 1 million slaves from the tobacco-producing northern slave states south to be sold at Natchez or New Orleans. In the 50 years before the Civil War, 1 million such slaves were sent down the river, as it was called, to the cotton-producing deep south, and most families were broken apart. There's a recent treatment of this subject in some detail in the current issue of the Smithsonian magazine. So somehow this material is beginning to come forward into a broader setting. Now, Indians in California were not bought and sold. Put in a small sidebar here, the Spanish knew all about slavery. They had slave boats. They had societies with slaves and slave societies, the difference being slave societies were primarily run by slave labor. The Spaniards did not classify Indians as slaves. They were classified as wards of their parental elders and local parentes of the Franciscans. Indians were not bought and sold. The families were kept together. One has only to read the mission records to see how earnestly the Franciscans identified those baptized, their children, brothers and sisters, and parents. Indians were allowed to go out on pass, or paseo, furlough if you like, for up to a month a year. Slaves could not do that. And in all my years of studying slavery in the United States and Latin America, I have never, ever heard of a slave master or plantation owner who told his workforce, someday, all of this will be yours. I am just keeping it in trust for you until you can learn how to manage it. But that was precisely the position and the role the Franciscans saw themselves playing for these Indians. Once they had trained them up to it, they were going to become free citizens and create in their own pueblo. Now, the relationship of the Indian to the mission was not one of complete freedom. We have a difficult time in the United States understanding that unfair labor can exist and even coexist with free labor. Now that's something we can discuss in the interaction if you like. I have classified or called this relationship of the Indians to the missions spiritual debt peonage. Did the Spanish military and the Franciscans, led by Serra, commit genocide against the Indians? The charge of genocide against the Franciscans began with the journalist, Kerry McWilliams, who made the allegation following World War II. He based his charge upon the horrible Indian population decline under the mission system. Sherburne F. Cook was the first to attempt to quantify Indian population decline, and he calculated that from 1769, the first mission, to 1848, the American conquest, 72% of the population at contact had died, overwhelmingly from diseases that the Spanish had unknowingly introduced into the population that had no natural immunity to them. That decline came over an 80-year span. Cook contrasted that 72% decline over 80 years with the 82% decline that the Americans imposed over the long decade from 1848 to 1860. Indian decline under American rule came from intentional acts to destroy Indian food sources and deliberate murder. What is the difference in intent between the Spanish and the Americans, and does it matter? The Spanish goal was to include Indians into their social system. There was no intent to destroy Indians. Such a policy was counterproductive to their goal. The American intent, however, was to exclude Indians, either by forcing them onto reservations or killing them. Getting rid of Indians from white society was the American goal. And apropos of Greg's reference to the end, or the edge of the continent, where were you going to deport Indians from California? Into the sea, or maybe worse, back to Oklahoma? But this is the choice, inelegant as it was, confronting white people trying to figure out what to do with native people in California. Does intent matter? It does to historians because much of the tragedy in the record of humankind comes as an unintended consequence of behavior. But we historians are not alone. If we turn to the United Nations Convention on the Prevention and Punishment of the Crime of Genocide, we find in Article 2 the following. In the present convention, genocide means any of the following acts committed with intent to destroy in whole or in part a national, ethnical, racial, or religious group. Murder of members of the group is number one. Dividing up families and sending children from one group to another, and number five. By this standard, American slavery and American treatment of Indians were both genocidal. Sadly, you do not get the context of the past and history courses about this until you get to college. So what did happen in California? What is the pertinent context? It was not genocide. It was not slavery. But it was an attempt deliberately to control and remake Indian culture. And coercion was used to accomplish that goal. James Fallon, a Lakota man with whom I've been in conversation for most of this year, uses the term culturicide. It's a kind of a mouthful, culturicide. But I think this is something that we need to work on and develop a conversation about, because certainly that was the intent. Think of Serra for a moment, if you will, and it might resonate slightly differently. The man was born and spent in a Spanish province, but his first language was Mallorquin. His second language was Spanish, then he had Latin. But for Serra, losing your language wasn't a big deal. Right? and nor was losing your name. His identity wasn't locked into it because he was willing to change it when he became a Franciscan. Right. We're always told we shouldn't judge others by ourselves, but invariably we tend to do so. So his frame of reference was one where it was not an issue to not speak your language or to go someplace where you couldn't speak it, or to change your name. But the byproduct of this, you know, bringing together of Indians for this directly cultural change, the unintended byproduct was death. And certainly by the end of the mission system, the last Spanish Father President, Mariano Paredes, writes to his superiors in Mexico City and said, "What will be said of us? We got here and found a large, healthy Gentile population." Gentile was their word for the non-baptized. "We find this large, healthy Gentile population, and we have laid it waste. They are dead and dying in our missions. How will we explain ourselves? Is it possible that the entire operation has been wrongly done?" Now that is self-insight, self-awareness at the end of the Spanish role. So I say again, context is crucial to understanding the past, and I thank Greg and Westmont for providing the opportunity for us to begin this conversation tonight.
Thanks, Jim. We will have plenty of, I think you can probably anticipate, opposing views here, and that's what we should have. That's what a university is. And we're gonna have the panel talk to each other after we're done, and we're gonna have you open the Q&A up to you too. There is nothing about Junipero Serra and the missions that's cut and dry. It's a very complicated situation, a story. Okay, number two. Dr. Ruben Mendoza is not only an original and productive scholar and archaeologist of the California missions, his own faith journey has been the subject of penetrating commentary by the Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist for the Los Angeles Times, Luis Sahagún. In a piece titled "Often Criticized, Serra Gets a Reappraisal from Historians," you will find copies. I think I handed a few people a copy of it. But you'll find other copies of this extraordinary story by Sahagún about Ruben outside on the table. At the University of Arizona, where Dr. Mendoza received his PhD, he studied under one of the founders of Native American Studies, Vine Deloria, the celebrated author of "Custer Died for Our Sins." Mendoza is a founding member of the faculty of the California State University at Monterey Bay. Among his many figurative and literal ground-breaking discoveries are solar and lunar illuminations at 13 of the California missions that may have been planned by the Franciscans to appeal to the indigenous peoples. In 2007, Dr. Mendoza made his biggest discovery, the original Serra Chapel of 1770 near the Monterey Presidio. Ruben joined Gail Beebe and me for the canonization with Pope Francis. We're so pleased to welcome him to Westmont.
Good evening. I want to thank you for the invitation to be able to partake of this journey on the trail of Serra, or some might refer to as El Camino Real. In this particular case, I bring a perspective that is born of having as a native Californian, in the sense of having been born in California, but not as an indigenous Californian. I am of Mexican Indian descent. And one of the equations or the elements of this entire discussion that I feel, at least from the outset, that has been left out is the fact that Serra and many of his compatriots were accompanied by Mexican indigenous elements. Whether they were Tlaxcaltecan or others from Baja California, they have been left out of the dialogue. And while I understand the politics of California Indian identity, I do realize that there were no borders at one time that we identify with the U.S.-Mexican border. And so oftentimes I see those arguments as somewhat vacuous. What I wanted to do is I have some pieces here that I want to read to you that really relate to what I feel that Serra and his compatriots, including those individuals that accompanied him, brought to California. Many of these elements are aspects of whether Roman tradition, European tradition, and other Mesoamerican traditions that all reconcile, become part of a hybrid introduction into California. many of these dimensions, whether it's hydraulics, engineering, architecture, Vitruvian and otherwise, all of these are introduced at a time that begin to formulate what would become the California of today. And for whatever it's worth, while there are those of us that might reject the colonial paradigm, and I do, I identify as Native American, the reality is that we are products of that experience. And in attempting to identify and dialogue with Latino youth, 40% of the youth, or at least of the populations of California today, are Hispanic or Mexican origin. And that is a population that has been left out of this discussion almost entirely. And so as a result, because of the Los Angeles Times interview that was done, there was an opportunity, at least for a moment, to be able to reintroduce that dimension of the Hispanic Catholic tradition. And so I read to you a statement, and part of the statement was presented before the State Assembly as part of the effort to retain the Sarah statue in Statuary Hall in Washington, D.C. I was literally called after having returned from a conference. I'd gone to Rome as part of a group of scholars identified with basically presenting testimony regarding Fray Junipero Serra. And when I returned, one of the most salient questions was this whole issue about the removal of the only Hispanic Catholic representative in Statuary Hall in Washington, D.C. When I was in at the Vatican and I was interviewed by the Latin American media, that was their primary question. Why is this being done? And my response was that this was a form of erasure that has existed in all times and places, which generally targets those symbols which, whether by virtue of political expediency, political correctness, or by virtue of the moment in time in which they are being reappraised, will be erased or defaced or decapitated, as in the case of the decapitation of the Sarah statue in Monterey, which occurred just recently. And this was a granite monument from 1891, and the head was lopped off. Again, it harkens to a number of different dimensions, which I can identify with both as a descendant of Native American communities and as a Mexican American who grew up in California and Southwest communities. Okay, I come to you from Salinas, California, the agricultural heartland of California. I come to you in my capacity as an expert witness, born of my role as a professor of anthropology and ethnohistory, specializing in the California missions. I also come to you as a citizen who was born and raised in this great state, and as such, am a product of this state's education system, for better or worse. Despite an early lack of desire to pursue my schooling beyond the basics, one experience kept me in school. That experience centered about a fourth grade field trip that departed Fresno, California for Old Mission San Juan Bautista in 1965. Though I really had no idea what I was looking at in the way of historic buildings or modern descendant communities, I did come away with an ardent desire to learn more about what I'd seen. To that end, I began poring over picture magazines regarding the Old West and eventually spending countless hours in libraries in and about Bakersfield, California. In sum, my experiences in the mission community of San Juan Bautista spawned my desire to pursue history in an effort to explore the questions of identity and basic curiosity. Without a firm grasp of who I was, I found in San Juan Bautista the seeds of a curiosity that would nurture my desire to know our state's incredible historical traditions. In the course of that quest, I eventually came to understand that I was not a descendant of the great empire of the Aztecs of Central Mexico, but rather the grandson to a woman of humble Yaqui Indian or Navajo descent, a resilient and determined woman born of a people who had overcome all odds to survive the otherwise harsh Sonoran desert, and a succession of invasions and depredations by outsiders. My grandmother, Erlinda Montes de Mendoza, shared her many powerful stories with me through to the day she died. Today, having earned my Bachelor of Arts degree at the California State University of Bakersfield and my MA and PhD degrees at the University of Arizona, I have redefined myself and my commitment to my Native American ancestors. Rather than permit popular lore, politicized agendas, and the pressures of powerful political lobbies and stockholders to define my perspectives, I remain committed to exploring and more accurately defining the historical traditions and those who sacrificed themselves in the pursuit of the California dream. While I can't say that I always identified with our state's mission history, in fact, I was actually antithetical to it, I've understood since that very first visit to Old Mission San Juan Bautista that the Hispanic Catholic tradition played a key role in our state's early development. As a person of Native American and Hispanic Catholic descent, I have long straddled and grappled with the identities and debates concerned with the role of the California missions in our state's history, particularly as this pertains to its indigenous descendant communities. As such, I would like to emphasize that given my lifelong efforts to identify the contributions and extol the virtues of my Native American ancestors through community engagement, professional presentations, publication, and advocacy, I do not take lightly the respective roles of European and Euro-American colonialism in the subordination and or demise of Amerindian communities across the Americas. My presentation here today is in no way intended to minimize or repudiate the Native Californian contribution in our history. Spanning thousands of years and a cultural ecology of profound depth, the Native California tradition was intimately embedded within a landscape yet untouched by those newcomers identified with subsequent Hispanic and Euro-American cultural and historical landscapes. Today, and bear in mind, this was part of the statement I made to the State Assembly, today I am here to review San Junipero Serra and that of the Order of Friars Minor as per their place in the early among the early founders of California. Having played a minor role in recent efforts to engage public outreach pertaining to the Serra canonization, I am well aware of the arguments of those detractors who sought to reverse Pope Francis's decision to canonize Serra. With that said, I can say without a doubt that San Junipero Serra is seen in a very different light than that which some Californians and outsiders would have us promote in an effort to minimize the Hispanic Catholic contribution in California and U.S. history. Having explored the Mediterranean Isle of Mallorca, where Miguel Joseph Serra y Ferrer was born to humble means in 1713, I recently had the opportunity to visit the site of Serra's boyhood home in Petra, Mallorca, and did so in the escort of those caretakers who have lovingly maintained said home for posterity. That home, that of campesinos, or field workers and cultivators of a small finca or parcel of land, resonated with my own experience as a boy who spent a good deal of my youth working in the agricultural fields of Central California. Serra's early years as one given over by his family to the church for service to the Lord was one that Miguel Joseph, or Junipero Serra, took quite seriously. Despite a stellar career as a professor of theology in Palma, Mallorca, Serra found his calling in the Franciscan mission community. To that end, he turned away from all that he achieved in his young life and at age 35 embarked for the New World and the missions of the Sierra Gorda, Querétaro, Mexico. In the wake of the expulsion of the Jesuits from the New World in 1768, Fray Serra was assigned to the missions of Baja California and subsequently was tapped in 1769 to launch that missionary enterprise for which he is best known, that of the founding of the missions in what was then the province of Alta California. By the end of his life in 1784, Fray Junipero Serra had personally seen through the founding of 9 California mission Indian communities, each of which has since evolved into one of the many great urban centers identified with California and its history. His legacy was sustained through the efforts of his protégés, who went on to found another 12 mission Indian communities that in turn served as the epicenters for the emergence of the great cities of California. So, when we begin to interrogate what it is that Serra and his compatriots introduced to California, what was different, what was new, what is foundational, we can begin to look at the very sacred geography, the founding of communities, mission Indian communities, that essentially became part of what I believe was a sacred geography, in which each site was basically predicated on the saint to which that site was devoted. As such, when we think of the great California cities of San Diego, Carmel, San Gabriel, San Luis Obispo, San Juan Capistrano, San Francisco, Santa Clara, and San Buenaventura, Monterrey, and Santa Barbara, Fray Junipero Serra's legacy is most apparent. And to that extent, Arnold Schwarzenegger's enunciation of California was in fact correct. In addition to his role as founding father of these great California cities, Fray Serra introduced many of those technologies and traditions and the very political economy on which the great state of California today depends. Moreover, much of what we today identify with California's vernacular architectural tradition is intimately identified with mission revival styles of the late 19th and early 20th centuries. To that end, it is not uncommon to spy modern skyscrapers, shopping malls, and public works projects that bear the indelible stamp of the California missions tradition. So whether we are cognizant of this fact or not, the reality is that the whole of California tradition continues to pay homage to the founding traditions of the Hispanic, Catholic, and indigenous traditions of early California. Whether identified with Olvera Street in the heart of Los Angeles, or the Presidio of Santa Barbara, or that of San Francisco, the very settlement patterns and patterns of urbanization that define modern California cities owes much to the founding principles of Fray Serra and his compatriots of that time. We shift to agriculture and ranching, many of the elements that identify the American cowboy. When looked at strictly in terms of his contributions to shaping the political economy of California, the hand of this founding father is ever present. His immediate contributions span the introduction of agriculture, as we know it today, and the introduction of many of those vegetable and fruit crops upon which we depend, including grapes, figs, olives, oranges, apples, pears, artichokes, tomatoes, potatoes, maize, beans, squash, wheat, barley, chickpeas, etc., etc., etc. This same humble friar saw through the primordial introduction of the very ranching industry that we today identify with the American cowboy, and with that introduction, Serra and his compatriots introduced cattle, horses, oxen, burros, pigs, mules, goats, sheep, chicken, and a host of other animals upon which we continue to depend, caged or not. With both those agricultural and ranching traditions, Serra and company introduced all of the essential elements today identified with the American cowboy, including the lariat, the chaps, saddles, and the rodeo, or rodeo, which continues to hold a central role in our celebration of this American tradition. Viticulture, and I can drink to that. Viticulture, Serra and his compatriots introduced viticulture using selected grapes cultivated in the earliest of missions to produce the earliest of wines and brandies in California. In fact, one of the first brandies came out of Mission San Gabriel. Today, the wine industry's prosperity owes a great debt to Fray Junipero Serra and his introduction of this essential California industry. As with virtually all of the crops introduced by Serra and the Franciscan or Fernandinos, all constitute the heritage plants from which virtually all modern California crops resulted. Waterworks, and some of you who have been following the newspapers of late are aware of recent projects by archaeologists done in the Los Angeles Basin that have recovered elements of these aqueduct systems at places like San Gabriel. In order to maintain such an industry within the broader context of the Hispanic agricultural traditions upon which we all depend, Serra and his peers saw through the construction of massive public works projects in the Los Angeles Basin, San Diego, San Francisco, and other early mission communities with an eye to channeling waters via an extensive system of masonry aqueducts, dams, mills, weirs, reservoirs, and wells. Dams can be, in fact, seen near the site of Mission San Diego de Alcalá. All of these part of that effort to generate communities that could be sustained through time, Mission Indian communities, no less. These include the massive complex of irrigation networks and aqueducts identified with the channelization of water through the Los Angeles Basin, a system that served as the blueprint for the earliest such Mexican and American water control systems on record. Land tenure. Unlike other U.S. states, so profound was the imprint of the California missions and its ranching traditions that California's very adoption of the quad and plat system of mapping necessarily adopted or had to accommodate pre-existing land boundaries born of ranch lands and mission holdings. Based on the so-called diseños, or late Spanish and Mexican era land grant maps produced to document land tenure, the imprint of the California missions and ranchos serves to distinguish California from all other American states by virtue of having accommodated the pre-existing land tenure system identified with the California missions and Fray Serra's place in founding said system. And if I'm presently looking at these diseños, and it's very clear that unlike the rest of the continental United States, California's boundaries for these so-called plat maps actually follow these ancient mapping systems of the mission and subsequent periods. I'm not sure where I'm at with time.
A couple more minutes.
Okay. I wanted to address two other topics before I shift out. I'm almost done. While art and culture in contemporary society is often relegated to secondary consideration for public schools and the political economy of our great state is concerned, the reality is that these traditions were elaborated with those Hispanic Catholic introductions that were transformed and enhanced by the hands of native Californians. Architectural styles traced to the Roman Empire, and the first century BC design guidelines of the Roman architect Marcus Vitruvius Pollio. Ecclesiastical art traceable to the great designs of Italian, Spanish, French, and German artists of the 16th through 18th centuries, books and the 16th century printing presses of Mexico City, medicine and the first published medical treatise ever produced in early California, democracy and indigenous voting rights and balloting, bureaucracy and governance, metallurgy, carpentry and ceramics, maritime traditions and cartography, and the many Mesoamerican indigenous foods and traditional technologies identified with maize agriculture were first introduced and deployed by Fray Junipero Serra and his compatriots in California. Ultimately, I contend that Serra and the Hispanic contribution continue to dominate the very political, economy, culture, architecture, and agriculture and stock raising traditions that define us as Californians. Finally, and ultimately, Fray Junipero Serra's role in the founding of the California Mission Indian Communities takes on a wider significance when one considers Serra's direct role in supporting the American Revolution. And I know there's some debate about this, and we've talked about this. Following the Spanish royal decree of June 21st, 1779, when King Carlos III declared war on England, the people of the Spanish royal presidio of Monterey supported the American colonies through, quote, military preparedness and financial contributions, unquote. According to the California Sons of the American Revolution, quote, their support directly aided the victory and independence of the United States of America, unquote. To that end, on August 17th of 1780, Fray Junipero Serra orchestrated a one-time voluntary donation from each person in the presidios and missions of Alta California. The Real Presidio de San Carlos de Monterrey alone contributed the equivalent of 833 pesos at that time, and this amount represented 30% of the total contributions sent from Alta California. This amount was significant for its time, at a time when the American Revolutionary Movement faced formidable challenges from the British Empire. Fray Serra's mission, San Carlos Borromeo Carmel, contributed 106 pesos, and in 1780, other mission and presidio sites contributed a total of 1,744 pesos. To that end, on June 2, 1976, King Juan Carlos I stated that, and I quote, Fray Junipero Serra, the father and founder of California, sent a dispatch dated June 15, 1780, to the Spanish missions in California, asking the friars to pray for the victory of Spain and asking the Spaniards to contribute with 2 pesos each and every Indian with 1. The amount collected in kind was delivered to the Viceroy of Mexico, who in turn sent it to the General Rochambeau, who participated with his French troops at the Virginia campaign in 1781, along with Washington, Lafayette, and Wayne. And I'll leave it there and move to discussion.
We've got just about everything under the sun coming from California, from Junipero Serra. Their legacy is astonishing, but I think whatever you think, it's certainly a little bit more voluminous than Sally Ride. If you've ever had the fine experience of delving into our Natural History Museum of Santa Barbara, just behind Mission Santa Barbara, you are walking into much of the handiwork of its curator of anthropology, Dr. John Johnson. Dr. Johnson received his doctorate from UCSB, where he lectures today as well. He is the author of over 100 publications, such as Toy Purina, 3 generations of an Alta California family. Fascinating study that John did of an Indian shamanist that actually led a revolt against Mission San Gabriel, like some sort of a Joan of Arc. And John traced Toy Purina's lineage over the next 100 years. He's edited several books, including last year's Treasures of Native California, The Legacy of Russian Exploration. A specialist on the Chumash, John's knowledge of California Indian life is indeed voluminous. He's just the right scholar to do the authoritative book on the subject we currently lack. Dr. Johnson did selfless duty inspecting my own manuscript and bending me to treatments of the indigenous peoples I might otherwise have missed. So it's a pleasure to say thank you, John, in person and in public today.
Okay, thank you, Craig. So I thought what I would do today, Ruben has talked about the contributions, the Hispanic contributions to California by Junipero Serra and the mission system. But I'm going to talk a little bit about the mission system and its interaction with California Indians, and also highlight a little bit what's unique about the native people of this region, the Chumash Indians. Chumash Indians spoke six different languages. The people we call today Chumash spoke six different languages in a unique language family, the Chumash language family, that was an isolate family found only in this corner of California and unrelated to any language families anywhere else in North America. Linguists tell us this is probably the result of a very long presence in this part of California, possibly back to the very first migrations that peopled the Americas. They say that one of the best cases for a basement language of California is the Chumash family of languages. In terms of achievements in material culture, these are four things for which Chumash Indians are known for across the country and even indeed worldwide. One is their development of the Tomal, or the plank canoe, which was first seen in 1542 by the Cabrillo expedition, which they talk about how impressed they were by this watercraft. And every single observer, Spanish observer, who came later talks about the importance of the plank canoe. It was only used anywhere in North America along this part by the Chumash and their neighbors, immediate neighbors to the south, as a watercraft going back and forth to the Channel Islands. The Chumash also developed a money economy, a bead money economy, based on shell bead money manufactured on our Channel Islands off the coast. And these beads produced on the Channel Islands circulated as a medium of exchange throughout the southern half of today's California, and were even traded beyond out to the Pueblo Indians on the Rio Grande, and Chumash bead money has been found even in the Great Plains in archaeological sites. And the name Chumash actually derives from the name the mainland Indians had for the Indians on the Channel Islands, because they made alchun, which is their name for bead money. Chumash means something like the bead money makers, referring to the Indians of the Channel Islands. Today we use that term to refer all these people speaking these six different related languages. The Chumash Indians are, as are other California Indians, are famous for the fine quality of the basketry that they made. And these baskets are prized by museums across the country and by collectors because of their great quality. And when Anza was here in 1776, he mentioned, and Font complains that Anza had some baskets that were given to him as part of by the Chumash, local Chumash, and that Font badly wanted one of those, but Anza never gave it to him, or promised to give it to him, but didn't. And then, of course, the Chumash rock paintings. And these are truly world famous. You know, people who study native rock art all over the world know about Chumash rock art. And this is a photograph here taken of Painted Cave, which if you haven't visited, you should go up and see Painted Cave State Park up on San Marcos. Okay, so into this region, there were five missions that were founded. First one being San Luis Obispo in 1772, founded by Junipero Serra. Then 10 years later, the first missions along the Santa Barbara Channel began to be founded. San Buenaventura in 1782, also founded by Junipero Serra. And then the other three within the territory where people spoke Chumash languages, the other three, Santa Barbara, La Purisima, and San Inez, came later after Serra's death. Serra was very interested in Chumash Indians and wrote about them. He really wanted to found missions along the Santa Barbara Channel. And he mentions when he would travel on boat by the Channel Islands, how he was very impressed with Chumash Indians and even that would come out to the ship when he was on his way to Monterey. And then later on, when he was passing along up the Santa Barbara coast, he mentions at Rincon Point, just down the coast from here, he mentions how there was a rainstorm. Yeah, and he was very muddy, and the Indians picked him up on their shoulders and carried him up the hill, so he didn't have to struggle through the mud. So my own work with Mission Records has been mainly, started with looking at the mission registers. My dissertation was on Chumash marriage and family patterns, and so I used these mission books and entered the data into a computer database. Later on, when I began working at the Museum of Natural History, we started another project working with Chumash Indians to enter the data and expand upon the data I had begun gathering when I was a student, doctoral student at UCSB. One of the pieces of information you can gain from this information is an appreciation of the total settlement pattern. The Franciscans were great record keepers, and so these documents can be read as anthropological documents to derive information about all of the Chumash towns and villages that were occupied contemporaneously. And so over the years, we've come up with about 150 different Chumash towns and villages, and this map shows their locations approximately. In some cases, we don't know exactly where they were. We can also use the mission records to estimate the original population of the California Indians. And so this map here is a GIS, using GIS, looking at the population densities along the Santa Barbara Channel. And what we find is that actually when we do this for all of Aboriginal California, that the highest population density in all of Aboriginal California was right here, the Santa Barbara Channel, and on our Channel Islands. So this was a very densely settled region of California, and California, compared to the rest of North America, was more densely settled and had higher populations than elsewhere in North America in Aboriginal times. So the Chumash region was extremely dense, all based not on agriculture at all, just on hunting and gathering and fishing. Okay, so in 1782, after Father Serra had founded Mission San Buenaventura, he moved up the coast, and he, with the governor of California, Felipe de Neve, who he didn't see eye to eye with Neve, but the two of them founded, and he did the ceremonies to found Mission Santa Barbara, or the Presidio of Santa Barbara.
Right.
And this is a map showing, made at that time that the Santa Barbara Presidio was first founded, showing the Santa Barbara area, showing the big Chumash town on the coast there, right about where Stearns Wharf is today, Siuctun. And then it also shows further east along the coast, you'll see another settlement called Shalawa, which is just downstream from Westmont College when you hit the coast. Yeah. That was Montecito, the original Montecito. Okay, so I mentioned that Junipero Serra and Felipe de Neve didn't see eye to eye. Felipe de Neve had a different idea when he came to California. He didn't want the missions to continue the way that they had been practiced up to that point. And so he ran, butted heads with Junipero Serra. So his attempt to change the missions, he wanted only one priest per mission instead of two priests per mission. He wanted no relocation of the mission Indians after they'd accepted baptism, so they wouldn't move to the missions. This meant that there would be no agricultural operations that would be directed by the missionaries at the missions, no large-scale farming operations. He felt that the Indians were only to be converted through the good example and teaching of the Padres. So they were not to be relocated to the missions. Well, so Junipero Serra didn't really know that this is what Neve wanted to do at that time. When he came to Santa Barbara, he conducted inaugural ceremonies for founding the Presidio and the mission, thinking that he was founding the mission at that time. But Neve said, no, we've got to build the Presidio first. The mission will come later. And so Serra left on his way back to Monterey. And then he discovered that Neve had this new idea that the missions were going to be completely changed from the way they had been founded up to that point. And so Sarah complained about this, and basically the king reversed Neve's plan later on that spring. So the missions continued to be founded the way that they had been, with two missionaries in each mission. The Indians, after being baptized, would move to the mission. And so here we have, now this is after Junipero Serra's passing, but this is the earliest image that we actually have of the Santa Barbara area made during the time of Vancouver's visit to Santa Barbara, 1793. You can see the big Chumash town of Siuctun on the Santa Barbara waterfront, and in the middle distance, the Presidio, and up in the hill behind them, the mission, as it was only 7 years old at that
time. Amazing.
This is a page from the mission baptismal register, and it's 1796, and it shows the baptism of a very important chief, local chief, and it says on the, I think if I can read it right, on the 12th day of the month of September, in the year 1796, I baptized the following adults. First, a man about 60 years of age called Yanonali. A chief of the rancheria of Siuctun, and a native of that same rancheria. He was father of Mateo Tatwith, and I gave him the name Pedro. Okay, so there's a street in Santa Barbara called Yanonali Street, named after this particular chief. He was the Pakwa, the big chief of the Santa Barbara area at the time the mission was founded. And so this gives you an idea of the kind of information that are in these records, very detailed records. It tells you his political status, it tells you where he was born from, where he was, you know, how he was related to an Indian who had been previously baptized, his age, and so on, and his native name, Yanonali. And this is the kind of rich information that these records contain. Okay, now there's another document that I studied a bit. It's a questionnaire about mission life just in 1800. And it answers some of our questions about what was it, what was life like at the mission for California Indians and Chumash Indians. And one of the questions was, is the Christian doctrine taught to the Indians in their own language? Are the Indians instructed in the principal and necessary mysteries of our religion before baptism? Are the Indians obliged to speak Spanish? Those are just some of the questions. Well, here's an answer to that question, which I think is very interesting. This is a document written down by one of the Chumash Indians from Mission Santa Barbara in beautiful handwriting. His prayer, saying a prayer of the act of faith in his native language, Barbareño Chumash, carefully copied out and written down in the native language. And this document's at the Smithsonian Institution. It was preserved by the son-in-law of this man. It was then passed along to the chief of the San Ynez Indians, who's shown here in this photograph, Rafael Solares. This photograph was taken at his studio here in Santa Barbara or in 1879 by a French anthropologist who was visiting Santa Barbara. And Rafael kept this prayer. He was at Santa Ynez, and then turned it over eventually to someone in Santa Barbara who turned it over to a linguist who sent it to the Smithsonian. So that's why we have it.
Our Father?
But it shows that, you know, the prayers were taught in the native language.
Right.
They did learn Spanish. They became the people, Indians, who were instructed at the missions. Some of them then became literate and would record documents like this. So how many hours are the Indians made to work? Well, some of these documents from this 1800 questionnaire, it says the work starts 2 hours after sunrise. That's about when I go to work. Work ceases a quarter after 11 o'clock in the morning. Gosh, I wish I could do that.
Yeah.
It says in the afternoon, the Indians never work more than an hour and a half. So there was a big time from the heat of the day where people would take a break. They said those who were assigned to making adobe bricks would make 40 bricks a day and would be usually finished by noon. And they said the weavers would make 10 varas of cloth a day and get extra pay for weaving more than the minimum. So this is, according to the missionaries, this is the work schedule at the missions. They also mentioned, and there's many other things in this document, but here's another thought, thing I found interesting, that after the crops were gathered, the mission crops were gathered and harvested in the fall, then the Indians would be free, leave the mission for sometimes up to 2 months at a time, to leave the mission and go into the backcountry and harvest the native crops which they had traditionally gathered, like the islay, the cherry pits, wild cherry pits, and the acorns, which were major staples in California Indian diet. Okay, well the tragedy of the missions is the high mortality which was mentioned earlier by Jim Sandoz. And this is just charting out, using the registers of the mission, showing the death rate at the missions here in what is now Santa Barbara County. And you can see that there are peaks, that in the beginning and during Sarah's lifetime, there wasn't a high mortality at the mission. So Nebra Sarah didn't live to witness this tragedy of the mission period. There's a big epidemic you can see in 1801. It's probably diphtheria. The worst epidemic of the mission period was 1806, a measles epidemic that swept through California, from Baja California, swept through all the mission chain within a 5-6 month period. And then you have later on measles again, 1821. But you can see there's a gradually increasing mortality among people at the missions. And if you look at this another way, if you look at it showing in this chart, this is taking just one Chumash rancheria, one village. The red bar, the first bar, shows the about 100 people baptized from this village. The second bar there shows the children of that first group that are born to them, listed in the baptismal register. Then in the group number three are the children of the second group.
Mm-hmm.
The group number four are the children of the third group. And the group number five are the children of the fourth group.
Wow.
And you can see that this is what happened at all the California missions. There was a high infant mortality. The average life expectancy of a person born at the missions was about 8.5 years. Okay, wow. It was because of the high childhood mortality that took place from the lack of immunity to introduced diseases. And so each succeeding generation, there were fewer and fewer people. The people were not reaching adulthood and then having children themselves. And so you get this decline in the population. So by the 1830s, by 1840, the Santa Barbara region, for the first time, the non-Indian population is exceeding the Indian population. There have been almost a precipitous decline. So only maybe perhaps 10% of the people were still alive who had been of the population that had been here at the beginning. But this doesn't mean that there wasn't a viable Chumash community. There did continue to be a Chumash community in Santa Barbara. And this is Luisa Ignacio, who was a native Chumash speaker who lived in downtown Santa Barbara. She had a ranch, inherited a ranch, later on moved into town, into Santa Barbara, lived right across the street from where the Santa Barbara Historical Museum is today. That was her home. And she, into the 20th century, was interviewed by the anthropologist John Harrington, recording Chumash stories, documenting her language. And so today we can document the Barbarima Chumash language. We know a lot about the oral traditions and the culture history of Chumash Indians from women like Luisa.
Hmm.
But it didn't stop there. This is Luisa's granddaughter here, Mary Yee, and she is married to a Chinese man. That's why she got the surname Yee. And she here she is being interviewed in 1949 on KTMS radio here in Santa Barbara, where she's speaking with her great uncle. And there you can, when you listen to that interview, you can hear We have a recording of it at the museum. We can hear the two native speakers speaking to each other in their native language. And then we have Mary Yee's daughter here with us today, Ernestine. Raise your hand. So in the Santa Barbara Mission, there's a wonderful prayer board that maybe Tina will talk a little bit about, but it has the Acts of Faith, Hope, and Charity written down in Barbareño Chumash. And so that was borrowed by the Huntington Library a few years ago when they did their Junipero Serra exhibit. Yeah. And because Ernestine heard her mother speaking the native language when she was little, Ernestine, even though she's not a fluent speaker herself, she has very good pronunciation.
Yeah.
And so Ernestine took her mother's notebooks where her mother had recorded the Acts of Faith, Hope, and Charity, and read, it was recorded so that when you went to the Huntington Library, you could look at that prayer board, pick up the earphone, and hear the language being spoken. And that's all.
Thanks, John. That was a wonderful presentation. I'm sorry that those of you over here probably couldn't see it too well, but really wonderful, wonderful in-depth look at our indigenous past, and particularly in the Santa Barbara area. I think one of my colleagues in Westmont, I think Paul Willis, once said, this was the New York of the United States during the indigenous period. Santa Barbara was the largest city in this whole area. All right, Christina Foss will top it off for us. Christina founded Native American Studies at Santa Barbara City College and has taught there for 40 years. She is the director of the Mission Santa Barbara Museum. Any of you have been through it? That's in care of Tina's work. Where her daughter Lauren works in the front office. Nice to see you, Lauren. And she has decades of experience working with the Chumash. A seventh generation Californian who traces her family back to 1847 in Santa Barbara, very early, pre-Gold Rush by a year. Tina herself is also of Muscogee Indian parentage. Tina has a big surprise for us. Those of you who've been patient and lasting through our big long panel, hopefully we're gonna get rewarded with something here. And we've already introduced Ernestine DeSoto, the daughter of the last native speaker, Chumash Mary Yee. But I think that Tina is going to share with us a rather miraculous story that Ernestine has. So Tina, it's great to have you here.
I think my role really is, as we wrap this up, to bring this from the historic realities to the present day realities. I want to talk a little bit about navigating the legacy of cultural loss, the realities for California's Native people today. The Native response to Serra has been varied. Mostly what we've seen in the media has been negative response, but there's been various positive responses too. It's been really interesting. And some people say, well, if some Native people feel one way and some feel another, it must be, you know, somebody's wrong or has the story wrong. But I think what we really need to understand is that nobody has the story wrong. They have a different experience. Because all of us in our own lives bring different experiences to the table when we look at issues. And that's exactly the same for Native people. Some Native people had negative experiences in the past, in their own personal past or that of their family. And others had more positive experiences and handed those down through their families. And so today we see some realities that reflect the past. So I'd like to kind of tie those together a little bit. While there are many differing viewpoints among Native Americans today, one thing is common among California Indians, and that's a sense of cultural loss. This sense of loss is a loss that is hard to put into words. It's not just language or how to make a particular kind of basket or some specific. It's something larger that is part of identity. And so it's very difficult to view conquest in simple historical terms when it has a great deal of personal emotion for a person. And I think that's what we're seeing today. We're seeing that different groups of Native Americans disagree on many political issues, but they agree on cultural loss as a legacy of sadness. I think that those of you who've seen the film that John put together with interviewing Ernestine and discussing six generations of her family, some of whom you've seen in his presentation today, may remember that Ernestine put it very well in that film, that it's something you can't get back, and there's a sadness there as she talks about the hole in her heart. And I think that that's something that Native people share. Some people may feel that there must be somebody to blame, and we've seen with the historic realities that there was disease to blame, there was conquest itself, soldiers, whatever, and some people would feel Sarah. So we see that all these different viewpoints come together with this issue of loss, and many times the response that I've seen in the media is one talking about Indians on reservations today. But I have to tell you that most of the Native people who experience this loss in missionization do not have reservations today. Most of the coastal part of California is an area where no one held on to their land long enough to have the U.S. government come in three flags later and say, oh, this is your traditional spot, we'll draw a line around you and that's your reservation, you get that piece that's left. One Chumash group of all the Chumash from Malibu to San Luis Obispo managed to hold on to a piece of land long enough that the U.S. government showed up in, what, 1911, 1912, and actually drew a line around them and said, that's the Chumash reservation for, not the Chumash, from Malibu to San Luis Obispo, but for the five families that are living right there and their descendants. Now, what happens from that is that in California, like in many other states, we have two groups, but it's much bigger in California than many other places. We've got reservation Indians, and we've got non-reservation, unrecognized Indians who have no federal status of any kind. They're not sitting there with a casino and a big check. They're still experiencing the economic loss of missionization. And those are the people who we see talking about their past in missions and their history in missions. And I think there's been a lot of confusion about that in the media. They really don't get that, that there's two separate groups. Ernestine has in her family, Julie Tumamite in Ventura, her family. These are people who have more Chumash cultural heritage and bloodlines than many, many other people alive today, and yet the federal government says they don't exist, essentially, in the sense that they do not have federal recognition and federal roll numbers. So I view that as a kind of paper genocide. We've talked, we've kicked that word around this evening. But this is a paper genocide because what it does is say you're not who we know you are. We won't give you the status of being who we know you are and you know you are. And we can all prove here, and John's done the genealogies for, so we can literally lay out that there's no question that these people are, for example, the Chumash today. And yet that isn't there. So this sense of loss from former missionized tribes that are non-reservation Indians today extends to the very loss of their identity. So it was more than adjusting to the Spanish and then adjusting to the Mexican government that secularizes missions and then to the American government that says, well, we think you're Mexicans. And so you end up with a group of people today who feel much disenfranchisement and sense of loss. And since they all have that different opinions about, not about the loss, but on how to fix it, what can be done about this? The differences are rooted in the past, so I'd like to take a little look at that and just say, if we look at the past, some of the speakers have already talked about people like Toy Perina and Active Revolt at Mission San Gabriel. And when asked by the Spanish inquisitors after the revolt, why did you do this? She said, we wish you would just go away so it can be as it was before. All of us have experienced cultural change. Doesn't matter if you're 17 or 70, there's been something. We live in California where change is constant. And we've all experienced that. We drove out here today, and I grew up in Montecito, but when I grew up in Montecito, it was empty. 1950s Montecito was a very rural and very pleasant place. And I was going past buildings on Post Village Road thinking, oh, there was the drive-in, Blue Onion right there. Suddenly there's an Honor Bar there. And I was like, okay. That grew overnight. And you look at these changes and you kind of bemoan the loss of them. You know, your favorite restaurant, your favorite place, the foods you used to eat, the open space you used to run in that's now a six-story hotel. We see change. Now imagine California in the past and then these changes. You can understand where Toy Perina is coming from. Father Duran at Mission San Jose wrote in his diary that he had once asked, and he's really upset about this and somewhat mystified, he asked a young Indian man how he feels. He said, we've brought you all these things, learning, mathematics, science, all these wonderful things. Aren't you glad we came? And the young man looks in and says, no, I'd rather be back in my home village. And this story does not come from the Native American. It comes from Father Duran, who runs into his diary and writes it down and says, how can this be? I thought I was helping these people. I brought all of this. How can he want what he had? But it's the human spirit. We all want what we had. The loved ones who died, the town we grew up in that's been flooded or paved over with a freeway or whatever happened. We all want that. So Native people are no different. Some are accepting, and some say there were good things. Pablo Top, who's the only voice we have of a Native person recording what missions were like, the only voice, that's a first-person account of missions. Pablo Top, who had gone to Rome to study for the priesthood from Mission San Luis Rey, a Useño Indian, says, the priest at the mission lives like a king and we are his vassals, but it's okay because when he came, when the Spanish came, it ended war. And we were fighting all the time with the Indians at San Juan Capistrano, and the priest told us, we're all Christians, we can't do that anymore. And when you look at Top's account, you realize that here's somebody who had a valid conversion to Christianity, has accepted it, is being part of it. He sees the good and the bad, but he sees that in his mind, the good is outweighing it, what Sarah was hoping for. In Pablo Top's view. We see that local connection, and as John pointed out, there's a prayer board at Santa Barbara that lets us know that here people were praying in their native language. This was not one of these, one of the complaints that we've heard that the Spanish forced their language. Actually, that's American schools for Indians that did that. Children were forbidden to speak anything but English in American Indian schools up until the 1960s when they were disbanded after the Kennedy Commission investigation into how they were run. So we see these stories and these people from the past. One of my favorites is Father Sarah himself in his diary. And he says that everybody was getting sick and dying from dysentery at Mission Carmel, and he couldn't figure out what was wrong. He kept trying to improve their diet and make it better, and they were all dying. So he says he called in the village leader. He says, go home to the mountains and eat whatever it is you used to eat, and when you get well, come back. And of course, from a Native standpoint, I have to tell you, I keep wondering, come back? Okay, if I was really enslaved, would I come back? Well, they do come back, and they come back healthy. And Sarah writes in his diary, "I don't understand. I sent them away, and I had been feeding them more and more milk so they'd have more and more protein, and I don't know why they were so sick." And of course, in 1948, the USC Medical School, wondering why Native Americans were throwing out powdered milk to the annoyance of the US government, discovered that Indians lack the enzyme lactase to break down the lactose in milk, so it ferments in your stomach and your gut. And I have to tell you, I do miss ice cream. Well, anyway, every so often I'm bad and have some, and then I discover Indians lack the enzyme lactase. We don't even want to go there. So we know what was happening to these people. And did Sarah mean to kill them with dysentery and gave them more milk? No. So we have many of these stories. Now, from my standpoint, I see that as affecting today. We look at people today and we see they have their personal stories, that they have things that have affected them. I immediately think of the people that I know. David Velardis, chief of the Guaneño, who told me that he didn't want to see a mission torn down like some of these people who were speaking about how terrible life had been there, because he liked to go and put his hand on the wall of Mission San Juan Capistrano, because he said, in every brick, in every adobe, is the DNA of my ancestors. And when I put my hand on that wall, I am touching my ancestors. They're there for me. And Andy Galvin, active in the Sarah cause. And Andy has, in fact, you saw him, if you saw the canonization of Sarah, he brought Sarah's relics forward to the altar. And his cousin Vincent read the Ohlone prayer. His involvement has been for many, many years. And he is working with the Catholic Bishops Committee that's been formed to study how Native people are portrayed in missions, in museums, in docent tours, in everything, and to change that and make it possible for a dialogue to come out of Sarah's canonization and about the protest and difficulties, and instead turn that into something positive. And I'd like to share with you that in light of this committee, that there are Native people who do have different experiences today. And I should mention first that myself, I'm been teaching a long time and don't think in terms of miracle. And many of you know from reading in the media that Father Sarah, his canonization waived what's called the second miracle. The idea is that if somebody is with God, they can put in a good word to God for you, like Mary at Cana convincing Christ to turn that water into wine. That individual that's in heaven, that you pray to that saint, whatever, and say, go tell God to cure me, kind of thing. So with that thought in mind, Ernestine called me up. It's been a year and a half now?
2 years.
Almost 2 years, or just 2 years. And we had been standing by her daughter, Regina's, bedside at Cottage Hospital, and Regina had been unconscious, and the doctors had said it was time to pull the plug. And Ernestine called me and said, "If Father Sarah wants to be a saint, I think he needs a second miracle, and he could darn well do it for a Native American. That'd be a good thing, right?" And I thought, the doctors have said this is not happening, but in a mother's heart, you always want to have done every possible thing you could do to save your child. So I thought, it'll make her feel better. Okay. So I collected Brother Eric, and I said, who was working with the Sarah cause, and I said, I want you to bring a Sarah relic. We need to go and bless Regina. And so he brought the Sarah relic, and we went into the ICU, and we couldn't see Regina because she was in one of these beds that turns to keep you alive and was barely there. So came in, he blessed Regina, and I took him back to the mission, and I had to go and teach, and I did taught the classes. Then I come back to the hospital, and I walk into the ICU, and the bed is empty. And I am just devastated because I really wanted to be there with my friend, you know, when Regina left this world. So I call her up on my cell phone. I'm out in the hallway. Where are you? I'll come to you. Where are you? And she says, oh, we're checking out. I said, checking out? Yes, Regina woke up and she's in this wheelchair and we're going out to the car right now. I can't talk to you. The car's here. I'm leaving. I'm going, I don't believe in miracles, but this is kind of unusual. So I call up Andy Galvin, and I tell him, and he's screaming in the phone at me, the second miracle, we're all going to Rome! You're the witness! Okay, I'm the witness, I guess. And I want to tell you that when you look at people's personal experience, it can be very different. Someone who comes to the mission says, I feel my family was hurt here. You want to bring them in, let them pray as they see fit, let them heal in their own way. Because there's lots of different kinds of miracles and healing.
Right.
There's Ernestine and Regina, who's right here, looking really well. And there, all those different kinds of healing are what hopefully all of this controversy and different opinions will come to, is a better understanding here and now of people here and now today out of all the hard work of these scholars and out of the dialogue that comes forth.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I want to thank all the panelists again for that. Let's give them one more welcome.